Good morning, everyone. I'd like to begin with just a brief discussion of what our lesson is about this morning. And I'm going to stop right here. Is that plugged in?
Okay, now turn.
Yeah, it was not plugged in. So I'm going to give a brief discussion this morning of this doctrine of the great controversy. You remember last week I talked about how that this is really a unique doctrine to our church. But the interesting thing is this doctrine was not created by our church. This doctrine has been around since the Reformation. And next week, I promise what I talked about earlier, I will present to you how it became a doctrine and how Ellen White adopted it and used it in her writings. Because this great controversy is about nothing other than the moral government of God. Satan challenged God's right to rule the universe. He called God a liar. He called God a being who is out to make all of us, make him look good. And actually, the title of this week's lesson as we study the Great Controversy describes exactly that. The central issue before the whole universe that you and I are studying this quarter is about whether or not love or selfishness should rule. And Satan said, I'm going to get what I want. And if you're allowed to get whatever you want and you can be really in charge of yourself, you have true freedom. That's what he sold. And I shared a lot of that last week when we went through the lesson. So again, I promise by next week, we're going to talk about this doctrine of a moral government. Understand, the great controversy began when Satan rebelled. And then, of course, last week we talked about the fall of Adam and Eve. And remember, we studied this a couple years ago when we talked about the Old Testament setting up this process of the covenant of God. And God started out by giving that covenant to Adam and Eve in Genesis 3:15, where he said that he was going to bring about through a descendant or one of Eve's long-standing relatives or children, the Savior. And that's called the proto-evangelium. That's the beginning of the evangelistic covenant that God gave and never broke. And remember, the Old Testament had four major events that comprised the entire Old Testament. The first is creation. Then the second is the fall of man leading to the flood. So the flood's the major event that follows that. That's the second great event in the Old Testament. The third was the Exodus from Egypt, out of which the entire concept of the doctrine of coming out of Egypt and coming out of Babylon comes. And the fourth and final event in the Old Testament sets up the entire Old Testament, beginning with creation, then the flood, then the Exodus, is the exile and return from Babylon. Those four events are what the entire Old Testament is about. And all of the books of the Old Testament set up kind of in that sequence as you study and read them through. And understand, unfortunately, which we're going to talk about more today, God's own chosen people through his servant Abraham continued to fail him in that covenant. And this idea of what we're going to talk about today began in a prophecy written by who? Who wrote about this first in the Old Testament? Who's the only prophet Jesus ever talked about as a prophet? and said, we need to study him. Who is it?
No.
Daniel. Daniel's the one that talks about this subject. And Daniel's the only prophet that Jesus spoke of in name that we should study. And so, I want to start with our memory text, but we'll have our opening prayer before. Dear Father in heaven, as we come to study about this incredible subject that you have asked us to understand, you've asked us to know this, because you are coming very soon, and we live long after you came and set this up, and we are in those end days. So, dear Father in heaven, bless us as we learn about you this morning, I pray, through your Holy Spirit. Amen. Our memory text this morning comes from an incredible passage in Isaiah. It's one of the great promises in the whole scripture. And as I've always requested, I always ask that you bring your Bibles with you. And I'd really like you to read this text with me in your Bible. And I'll take just a minute here while you have a chance to look it up to read it with me. It's found in Isaiah 41, verses 8 through 13. That is our memory text passage, because if you read the whole passage, it has even greater impact as we talk about it. So if we're almost there, everybody has this founded in their text, I'm going to begin to read it now. My friend, this is toward the end of the eighth verse. My friend, you whom I took from the ends of the earth, and this is our good Lord speaking to us, you whom I took from the ends of the earth and called from its farthest corners, saying to you, you are my servant. This is God speaking to you and me personally. You are my servant. I have chosen you and not cast you off. Now understand, Isaiah was speaking just about the time that Israel was going to be taken off into captivity, didn't he? This is before they went off to Babylon that Isaiah was speaking to them. And he spoke to Israel in particular, but also to Judea. You are my servant, and so this is speaking to us. We're his servant. I have chosen you and not cast you off. God has picked you and me. Fear not, for I am with you. This is a powerful statement. God is with you right now. If your heart is open to him through the Holy Spirit, God is with you. Fear not, I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. He belongs to you. He's given himself to us. This being who created the entire universe is your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And the right hand means the most powerful aspect God can give us is his righteous right hand. He will give us his righteous right hand. And he does that through his priest in heaven, doesn't he? He gives us his righteousness, doesn't he? He makes us whole. Behold, all who are incensed against you shall be put to shame and confounded. Those who strive against you shall be as nothing and shall perish. You shall seek those who contend with you, but you shall not find them. Anyone who has been your enemy or is your genuine enemy when you are righteous with God, God takes care of. God takes care of your enemies. You shall not find them. Those who war against you shall be as nothing at all. For I, the Lord, your God, hold your right hand. It is I who say to you, fear not. The one who helps you. Is that not an incredible set of promises? And that's our memory verse and passage for today. It's a great text to begin our study. The next text I'm going to read straight from Scripture, and it's found in Luke 19, and it's verses 41 and 42. And it has to do with Jesus looking out over Jerusalem, and he's sitting up on Mount Olivet, looking out through the Kidron Valley out toward Jerusalem, which is east of him. And here's what Jesus went through. And when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace. But now they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground, you and your children with you. And they will not leave one stone upon another in you, because you did not know the time of your visitation. And Jesus did that in tears. He was crying over the nation that he had spent that entire Old Testament trying to save. And they had rejected him, and he knew that within 1 week he was going to be crucified when he had this place on top of that mountain. And he was speaking in front of his disciples. And while they were in private, of course, the disciples began to talk to him on that mountain looking out over Jerusalem. They're looking at that temple when he said that. And this temple had been built up over 40-some years by Herod. Remember, I've shown you the picture of it and Herod's hall that he had that he did business in. It was this great center of commerce and everything else, and it had nothing to do with the right worship of God. And I'm going to remind us now and at the end, we are in that same place as those Hebrews were at that time. We're sitting here at the very end of time, and are we ready for that to end? Are you ready for that day comes when we're going to be tested? Do you know His Word? Are you ready? What central scripture are we talking about today as we start this lesson? Anybody know what the scripture was? Well, that's what we read. That's the promise. But what scripture are we talking about when it comes to the destruction of Jerusalem and the prophet and this prophecy that Jesus gave? It is Matthew 24. Matthew 24 is one incredible prophecy. I'll show you a little reference I have. Trust me, I could not put this lesson in more than at least a week's worth of Sabbath schools. This entire double-page folder is full of the lessons beginning Old and New Testament about Matthew 24. We all know about Daniel and Revelation, but Matthew 24 is an incredible prophecy, and we're going to talk about it a little bit this morning as we start going through our lesson. Pastor Stephen Bohr is the one who produced this manuscript. He's preached on ABN, and he runs his own Adventist mission, which is affiliated with our conference. And there is a critical aspect to this scriptural passage because it is one of the end-time prophecies. Matthew 24 is an end-time prophecy. And there are many types of end-time prophecies, and this is one of its own unique type. This prophecy has a very unique message. Number one, it was given to us directly by Jesus. This is Jesus' eschatologic message. This is His telling you what Daniel and Revelation tell you. This is how it works. There is a thematic way that we have prophecy through Ellen White. That's why she wrote the Great Controversy. And this week we're talking about the first two chapters of the Great Controversy. That's what we're studying. But it has to do with Matthew 24, which is the prophecy that Jesus gave us about the end of time. There's also typological prophecies that you can find in the Bible, like Genesis 3:15 that we started with, and also Cain and Abel, Sodom and Gomorrah, are all types that represent what can happen at the end of time. Then there's Daniel and Revelation, and these are called apocalyptic prophecies because they're written in a language that was very common from about 200 years before Jesus to 100 years after, and everyone knew what they meant, but we had to refigure it out in our time. We had to go back and study scripture that explains all of those messages that are given in symbolic forms, just the way it says in Revelation 1 verses 1 and 2. It is symbolic in that prophecy. This prophecy in Matthew is the only one that's given chronologically in order of all the events that are going to happen at the end of time. I've constantly said as I've taught, all the things that I teach are things that I've learned by studying these men who have been ordained pastors of our church and have spent a lifetime studying these and putting them into a form we can study. And I urge you to do the same for yourself. Find places that talk about these passages within our literature in the church so that you can understand them and put them in your heart, because we are living in that time. I would not be surprised if this world ends in the next 2 or 3 years. I believe that with my heart, that it could happen. We now live in a time when we have the time to be ready. Matthew 24 passage is given by Jesus himself, and it alone gives the exact sequence of last time events. And there are key facts about Matthew 24. Here's number one. I'm going to give you 7 of them. 7 key facts about Matthew 24. Number one, our messenger talks about this passage, and here's what she says. The 24th chapter of Matthew is presented to me again and again. Do you understand that? Our messenger from God was given this chapter over and over and over again by the Lord. That is an incredible statement. As something that is to be brought to the attention of all, we all need to understand Matthew 24. We are today living in the time when the predictions of this chapter are fulfilling. Let our ministers and our teachers explain these. That's what she asks. We need to know this chapter. These prophecies to those whom they instruct, let them leave out their discourses, matters of minor consequences, get rid of some of the stuff we're always talking about, and she says, and present truths that will decide the destiny of souls. That's how important Matthew 24 is. It is a critical passage in Scripture. For me, I think the number one passage in Scripture is in the middle of John 14 through 18, where Jesus explains the process of salvation in great detail. And I've presented that in many ways in this class. But this is as critical a message as any other in the Bible, is Matthew 24. Number two, it is critical to understand that this passage is not, and I repeat, not for secular people. This passage is for those of us who hear and are given to the Lord. It's not something we go out on the street and preach. We talk about it here amongst ourselves because we have a different belief. It is for end-time people who are faithful and true in the time of Satan's deceptions and persecution. That is what this passage is for. Matthew 24, verse 4 says this, Jesus answered them, see that no one leads you astray, for many will come in my name. That means it's to Christians. He wants you to know, as someone who believes in Jesus, that there's going to be people that are going to come around and they're going to pretend that they're him. It's already happened in our lifetime, hasn't it? David Koresh, wasn't he? A national event because he acted like he knew what he was talking about. Saying, I am Christ, and they will lead many astray. That's why we've got to know where to find what we need to know. My name indicates they are Christians. Then in verses 15 and 16, only believers will be able to understand. That's those different verses and what they say to you. Really learn this scripture in Matthew 24. Matthew 24, 15 and 16 says this. So when you see the abomination of desolation of the prophet Daniel standing in the holy place, let the reader understand, and let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Now we know that this passage had a dual meaning. It was not written just for the people who were in Judea. It was written for you and me when we come to that time when it's time to be aware of when it's time to leave. And we will not know that if we're fooled or anything else if we don't know this faith the way we should. Also, Matthew 24, verses 23 to 25, it goes on to say this. He was speaking to the disciples where it says, even in the very elect may be deceived. So even those who really think they know everything can still be deceived if we really don't have the Holy Spirit in our heart and aren't listening to our Savior as we study these passages. When we find who are the elect, here's what it says. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God to make intercession for us. God's elect are the people we've been talking about for 2 or 3 years that I've been teaching, are those who have taken Jesus into your heart and are justified or on your way to being sanctified. You are now God's elect if you're in that place. And if the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, you will not get confused by anyone who's fooling you. You will understand these passages. They are they whom God has justified, to whom Jesus, our high priest, has given his righteousness. That's who the elect are. And we can all do that right here now on our knees or when we have our worship every day, morning and evening, and in prayer throughout the day. Number three, we must all study all three accounts of what Jesus said in order to put it all together. And this manuscript I have here also goes into the Old Testament and explains all of that in Ezekiel and Daniel also. Matthew 24, Luke 21, and Mark 13 are all different passages that explain different aspects of this so that we can put it all together, even though we're going to go over it briefly this morning. Matthew 24, 9 and 10 says that there's betrayal, and Mark 13, 11 to 13 says who, which means our family. That's how you compare texts. When that day comes, and those of us who choose to follow the Lord, we will be betrayed by people who have chosen not to, and they may even be our most close family members. That is why Jesus says, with all love, you've got to put me first in your life, even over and above your family. Not that you neglect your family. We love our family. We pray for them. We help them. But every human alive will have that choice to make, won't they? Matthew 24, 15 says, desolation in the holy place. Mark 13, 14 says, abomination of desolation is where it ought not. This reference in Mark refers to Daniel saying, where it ought not, and Mark finishes with those who flee in Judea, flee to the mountains. So if you understand that message, you will know when it's time to leave. Luke 21, 20 says, the abomination of desolation is when the Roman legions besiege Jerusalem. Understand, the message that they got was too late when Rome actually conquered Jerusalem. We'll talk about that in a minute. But the abomination was when Rome first circled Jerusalem in 66 AD. That was the abomination. The desolation took place after they went around it again in 70 AD and they destroyed it after a long siege, during which women ate their children and there was no food in that city. It was horrific. Not only that, as they went to conquer Jerusalem, they destroyed all of Judea and everything around it. They desolated the Hebrew people, decimated Jerusalem, and totally destroyed it all. They did not want those people to be a problem again. The details are found in Luke. Number one, holy place was outside the cities. There was an area around Jerusalem that was considered holy. It was several hundred yards. So that holy place is where the Romans surrounded them and built up a wall around Jerusalem to attack it. Abomination is the siege, not the destruction. The desolation results from the abomination. Remember the phrase, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, know that it is desolation is near, but not here yet. Matthew 24 has a twofold fulfillment. I've already talked about that, but I'm reemphasizing that. So Matthew 24 that we're going to learn has a twofold fulfillment. Our messenger of God's thoughts on this subject go as follows. Christ forewarned his disciples of the destruction of Jerusalem and the signs to take place prior to the coming of the Son of Man. The whole of the chapter, 24th chapter of Matthew, is a prophecy concerning the events to precede this event. And the last great destruction of Jerusalem is used to typify the last destruction of the world by fire. When those last seven plagues come out, probation is going to be closed and we're going to be on the run. And we need to be prepared for that time by being one of those elect who are justified and sanctified. The prophecy which he uttered was twofold in its meaning. While foreshadowing the destruction of Jerusalem, it prefigured also the terrors of the great last day, the great controversy, page 25. Here's one more quote from her. Jesus did not answer his disciples by taking up separately the destruction of these two events. He mingled the description of these two events. He had opened the future events to disciples. If he had opened the future of these events to disciples, they would have been unable to endure the sight. He had to let them figure it out later. Remember, he is not yet crucified. They still thought he was going to build up a kingdom here on earth. And we'll talk about that at the end of my lesson this morning, in a special lesson I've gotten myself this week. In mercy to them, he blended the scripture of the two great crises, leaving the disciples to study out the meaning for themselves. When he referred to the destruction of Jerusalem, his prophetic words reached beyond that event to the final conflagration in that day. So this prophecy is for you and me. When the Lord shall rise out of his place to punish the whole world for their iniquity, when the earth shall disclose her blood, shall not more cover her slain. This entire discourse was given not for the disciples, but for those who should live in the last scenes of this earth's history. Matthew 24. Number 5. In the series of years in Matthew 24, there are a series of critical Greek words. In all these verses, there's some critical words in here that help us understand that it is in sequence. The Greek word tota means in the sense of thereafter, in a sequential set of events, or follows temporally. So all the way through there, you're going to see that word if you and I could read Greek. But this is the way I'm proving to you that this is the only prophecy that's sequential in its presentation when you read it. Number 6, the book, The Great Controversy, also follows in sequential order the very same events as in Matthew 24. So as you read The Great Controversy, Ellen White will read out those events to you as you read that chapter. Put the two together. Chapters 1 and 2 were our assignment for this week, and if you didn't read it, please find it and read it. It'll help you understand this in complete sequence. We can't go through it all in one morning. Number 7, it is also important to know that the word you in Matthew 24 always means all believers in all ages. It wasn't just about you at that time. It also had a projective verbal sense that said you and you all the way till now. That prophecy is for you and me. Rejection, desolation, and destruction. And you and I, if we're still alive, are going to live through that, I believe, in our lifetime, and I believe very soon. And we don't know. If we have an accident going home today, are you ready? We need to spend our time that we have now being ready every day of our life. Matthew 23, 37 to 39. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often I would have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. See, your house has left you desolate, for I tell you, you will not see me again until Jesus left the temple and was on his way when his disciples came to him privately and said this, tell us when these things will be and what will be the signs of your coming and the end of all these things. And Jesus was in tears as he did this and explained it. Blessed is he who comes to the Lord. That is what we will finally say someday if we're ready. And this is Jesus explaining that to the disciples in privacy. Matthew 24, 1 and 2 says this, as Jesus, the living Shekinah, left the temple, he spoke of its destruction, and without the Shekinah, meaning him, it was desolate. When he walked out of that temple for the last time, until he was crucified, the Shekinah was gone from its presence in that temple. And it became desolate. Remember in Daniel, the 70-year prophecy gave them 490 years to get it right. And they didn't. And even after Jesus died, they still had time until they stoned Stephen. And then that was when it was it. And then in 70 AD, they were wiped off the map in that territory. Matthew 24, 5 to 8 says this, preliminary signs. And Jesus said, see that no one leads you astray, for many will come in my name. I am the Christ, that they may lead many astray. And in your ears, and you will hear wars and rumors of wars. Have we not seen that? Are we not seeing it now? Are there not famines right now being caused by these wars? Gaza, Somalia. Everywhere in the world there is chaos. The weather. We are living in the middle of these signs right now in a way I've never seen in my lifetime. And now I'm up at the other end of it. We are living in this time. See that you are not alarmed, for this must take place. So don't be worried about it. If you have a walk with God, there's nothing to be worried about. You can be at peace with who you are. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places, and all these things are to be the beginning of the birth pains. Everything we're seeing now is nothing compared to what will happen at the end of time. The end of time is going to be a place that no one has ever seen on this earth before. When those four angels let go of the winds, we're all going to live in a different world. What comes next that coincides with verse 9? The restraining spirit of God is even now being withdrawn from the world. Hurricanes, storms, tempests, fire, and flood, disasters by sea. And are we not seeing it in real time on CNN? Every day of our life, we're seeing this go on right as it happens. This is happening in our life right now. Follow each other in quick succession. Science seeks to explain all these. The signs sticking around us tell of the near approach of the Son of God and are attributed to any other cause than the true cause. Men cannot discern the sentinel angels restraining the four winds that they shall not blow until the servants of God are sealed. Understand that when we're sealed, if we are righteous with God, and those winds are let loose by those four angels, the world is not going to understand whatever hit it. And neither will we if we're not ready. But God shall bid his angels to loose the winds, and there shall be strife as no pen can picture. The Great Time of Trouble, volume 6, page 408. Also in the Testimonies for the Church, volume 6, verse 408. That's the great time of trouble. Understand, there's going to be a time of trouble at the end of time, a little time of trouble before probation closes, and the great time of trouble after. That's the sequence. What comes next that coincides with verse 10? And then many will fall away and betray one and another and hate one another. Friends will prove treacherous and will betray us. Relatives deceived by the enemy will think they do God's service. In opposing us and putting forth the utmost efforts to bring us to hard places, hoping that we will deny our faith and we will be tested, but God will be with us when we are. One additional point found in Luke 21, 12 and 13, and you will be brought before kings and governors for my name's sake. This will be your opportunity to bear witness. This is the little time of trouble when we will bear witness for our Lord. What comes next that coincides with verse 12 and 13? Here it comes. Many will have to stand in the legislative courts. Some will have to stand before kings and the learned of the earth to answer for their faith. Those who have only a superficial understanding of the truth, those who do not know Matthew 24 as well as Daniel and Revelation, will not be able to clearly to expound the scriptures and give definite reasons for their faith. However, do not despair. Those who receive Christ as a personal Savior will stand in those last days. The Lord Jesus will give the disciples a tongue and wisdom. The Lord will be with you if you end up on that stand someday. He'll be with me if I'm on that stand. that their adversaries can neither gainsay nor resist their words, Luke 21:15. Those who not by reasoning overcome satanic delusions will bear an affirmative testimony that will baffle supposedly learned men. All of us will have that kind of power with the Spirit at that time and day if we are righteous with God. He will enable us to be able to defend His honor, not ours. Words will come from the lips of the unlearned with such convincing power from the unlearned. We'll still be able to give convincing power and wisdom that conversation will be made to the truth. Thousands will be converted under their testimony. The same way that went on in that early church, we will do during that time. Those who are the elect who survive the decimation of this church that will come at that time, we'll be able to do this. God will enable us to do it. So what was the abomination and its purpose? Here's what our messenger says. Christ forewarned his disciples of the destruction of Jerusalem and the signs to take place prior to the coming of the Son of Man. The whole 24th chapter of Matthew is a prophecy concerning the events preceding this event. And the destruction of Jerusalem is used to typify the last day destruction of the world. The prophecy which he uttered was twofold in its meaning. While foreshadowing the destruction of Jerusalem, it prefigured also the terrors of the great last day, and I've shared this with you earlier. The fall of 66 AD, in the fall of that year, Cestius Gallus and the Roman legions surrounded Jerusalem for 9 days. And they thought the show was over. And for some reason, and no one quite understood it, Josephus says, they just took off, and the Israelites took off after them and actually had great battles and won them, beating up the Romans as they retreated. That was called the abomination. That means they knew it was time to run. The retreat allowed the Jews to leave there without being pursued by the Jews or Romans and to prevent them from leaving in safety. And understand, at that time, all Christians were Jews, and they all worshiped on Saturday. In 67 AD, Nero picked Vespasian to put down this Jewish rebellion. So a year later, Nero said, none of this, let's get rid of it. And Vespasian with Titus came back, and in 70 AD, he surrounded Jerusalem. And after a prolonged siege during which those who were not Jewish Christians were starved, conquered, and ravaged, as well as totally destroyed, including the temple's every stone. And here's some pictures of what happened. Just as in the days of Jerusalem destruction, as in the days of the destruction of Jerusalem, you and I may well see both the little time of trouble and Jacob's trouble. And I believe it's coming very soon. And we will see those seven last plagues. I believe it's coming very soon. We are living in the last days. And the Lion of Revelation is going to be here very soon. Jesus is coming again. That is why we're studying this chapter this week and more in the few weeks that are coming. And his kingdom is going to do what? It hits those feet of clay and iron and it destroys all of these nations on earth. And he is coming again. Our author, Mark Finley, tells of incredible growth of the early church, and I'm going to go through this very quickly because I want to share a personal story with you. Acts 9:31, so the church throughout all Judea and Galilee, Samaria, had peace and was built up and were walking in the fear of the Lord. However, and also with the Holy Spirit, they were multiplied. Acts 2:41 says this, Pentecost, 3,000 men and their families came along. Acts 4, verses 4 and 31, 5,000 men filled with the Holy Spirit came into the church. 8,000 Hebrews were converted to Jesus at that time. Acts 5:42 did not cease teaching temple and house to house. They taught in the temple and they taught from home to home in Jerusalem. They were converting thousands. Then in Acts 8:1 to 8, Paul begins his persecution before he goes to Damascus. Colossians 1:3, gospel in all creation, Paul to the entire Roman Empire and the Gentiles. He turned the Roman Empire upside down with his message. There was intermittent Roman persecution clear through Diocletian, which was a 10-year persecution of the church. He tried to boil John the Beloved in oil, according to tradition, and he couldn't, so he sent him off to Patton. Acts 2, 44 to 37, Acts 3, 6 to 9, and Acts 6, 1 to 7, pooled resources in the church. They took care of everybody. And when some of the Gentiles said, "You're not taking care of our people," they set up deacons and others that were honorable to go about and make sure that all the widows were taken care of. And by the way, we have widows in our church who need your support. And it can be done anonymously. If you want to know who you can help, speak to the pastor. And he will not tell who it is, and he will tell you you're welcome to help. We have that available to us too here in this church. To this point, we've covered all the tenets of our lesson. And finally, on Thursday, Finley asked, gave us two texts. "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you are to love one another. By this, people will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another." If we love one another, we're going to turn this valley upside down to tell them that Jesus is coming soon. 1 John 4:21, "And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brothers." I hope you love me. I can use it. He quotes at the end from this guy named Rodney Stark, who wrote a very recent book on the rise of Christianity, and here's what he said. "Dionysius, and not the Greek god of wine and pleasure, this was the Greek Orthodox patriarch, which is the Pope of the Eastern Church. And he was in Constantinople, gave the history of how Christians during two different plagues gave no consideration for themselves, but went out and helped people in the street and died of the same disease, but didn't care because they loved the Lord and they loved their neighbors. Are we willing to do that? Do we know the Lord that well? They even took up people they're throwing into the street by their relatives and took them home and fed them and took care of them, even if they took on the disease and died themselves. I'm going to close with a final story. In Matthew 14 and John 6 is the story of when Jesus gave a talk, and at the end of that talk, he fed 5,000 people with some loaves of bread and some fish, and he reached the peak of his popularity. People were in that crowd that came from all over the Near East, and they wanted to make him king of Israel because they thought he can heal up anybody that gets killed in combat. This guy can get rid of the Romans and put us in charge of the world and make us rich and powerful. And all the disciples wanted Jesus to do that, and when Jesus told them to go and get in their boat and go across Galilee. Galilee is about 4 miles wide where he told them to go across. And it takes about 3 hours to row across that lake. And then Jesus went up alone into the mountain to pray. And this was around 6 o'clock in the evening. The disciples hung around through that afternoon until 6 o'clock in the evening. They finally got in their boat to go across like Jesus had told them. They didn't do what he asked them to do when he told them to do it. And guess what? A big storm hit them. And they're on that lake, and they are rowing for 10 hours. The Bible in John 6 tells us the rest of the story. It was about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning before they saw this ghost coming across the water, and they were so terrified, they screamed. They had been rowing for 10 hours on that lake thinking they're going to die, and then they are so scared that they scream. This is not some funny story. It's a real story. And they scream in terror, and Jesus said, "Calm down, it's me." And finally, the storm calms down, and Peter says, "Lord, can I walk out to you?" He had the faith. He said, "Sure, come on." He started walking, and then when he looked back to the boat, down he went, and Jesus saved him. What I want you to take from this story is this. We are sitting here now in a boat rowing like crazy because we have not done our study. We do not know Matthew 24. We do not know Daniel and Revelation. We do not know our scripture the way the Lord wants us to know it. And I'm asking anyone who's hearing me, I hope the story I tell you now helps you understand the urgency of what God is asking us to do. Shall we bow our heads? Dear Father in heaven, we come before you this morning in true humility. Guide us, teach us, and give us love one for another, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.